Good evening, everyone. I'm Felicia Fitzpatrick, your host for tonight's production of Regina Taylor's Vote, presented by the Oaks Collective in collaboration with Regina Taylor. Now, y'all, we are just a few weeks away from what might be one of the most important elections in this nation's history. I mean, the outcome of this election will affect every American, but particularly for young people and the Black community. So tonight, we will be hearing original works from three promising young playwrights: Chris Eli Black, Jasmine Matthews, and Bonnie Scott, as well as from acclaimed playwright Regina Taylor. Through the artistry of these playwrights and the actors who embody their characters, Vote is a call to action to our community and seeks to open up dialogue about why voting in this election and every election is imperative. And after the performances, please stick around for the live panel discussion. Our panelists will have a frank conversation about the Black community and our history and our relationship to voting in this country. And of course, if you've not done so already, please take a moment to register to vote. In fact, I'll wait right now. I'm just kidding, but please make time to do that tonight. It's super important. And with that, please enjoy the Oaks Collective and Regina Taylor's presentation of Vote.
Folks on the front lines putting their lives on the line, talking about, "I am not my grandma. Don't come for me like you coming for Jesus. I ain't about turning the other cheek. I am not your peaceful protesting Martin Luther, peaceful kumbaya sitting protest marching auntie. Not today. Nah. We the new Negroes. We gonna pillage and loot and burn everything down to the ground, cause we not taking it no more, is what you have on your hands today. If your question is why I won't vote, we ain't no Cosby Show Negroes up in here. You know what I'm talking about? Like, before Cosby went to jail. You know what I'm talking about, what he represented in terms of Black family excellence. Upper middle class doctor, lawyer parents and their kids should have been going to a private school and then Harvard, but the cool one went to an HBCU and thus the spinoff. That Cosby. That one before. I grew up with the Cosby reruns. Child of a single mother who went and got her life together after running the streets, running gangs since she was 15, and then went and got her GED and worked as a social worker, put three nappy-headed children through college type woman and never had a moment of complaint. Strong Black woman. That's my mama, who said, "I can be your mama and your daddy." But I don't think she thought she was trans. And I'm not talking about Caitlyn Jenner, who back in the day was just some white guy on the back of a Wheaties box. A good start to every morning. I'm talking about the Negro in my neighborhood who would sashay on the boulevard. But try them. Better not try them. Cause I think one of the strongest people in the world today gotta be Black and trans. And at the same time, my mama was just as strong. She taught me, you got to be in a system that sets us against each other, us and them. I mean, why else would you put up statues of traitors of the states, your civil wars, and then drag them down to incite those who've been indoctrinated in the graven images of Robert E. Lee and John Wayne and blue-eyed messiahs? My question: why a white boy can kill protesters on the street and just walk away with a gun in hand and be lifted up as a hero. But don't get caught with a bag of Skittles and an Arizona iced tea with a certain melanin. So, if your question is, if the choice is between the Donald, Biden, or Kanye. Now, we do know that the Kardashians have broken the mind of every man they've ever given entree into their Batcave. So let's just pretend I am in denial and ask, who do you think I roll with? Is this a multiple choice or trick question? They say I got choices, like I can choose to live or die. They give you this illusion that this is the land of the free and the home of, and totally ignore the Choctaw, the Cherokee nations. You see where I'm heading? They say, choose behind, what's behind door number 1, 2, or 3. Or do you want to take the cash? And then they flash $500. And you take the cash because it's a sure thing. You know you be going home with something. Pay a bill or two. And still have enough for a 3-piece fries and Coke. And still have some left over. You ain't no dope. You think you've out-reasoned the system. So you're telling me you're offering me a check with how many O's in it? To say, let's forget the whole thing. Here's your reparations. Now we're even. Hoping I'll take it, pass it back to you, buying my furs, my car, my bling, passing down a legacy of poverty, rather than invest into the sons and daughters and the ones that come after me. What I need to do is buy some land that'll appreciate at the same rate as yours. How to access those doors or make doors of my own that might be safe from Black Wall Street catastrophes. Because every time we get a little something, something, here they come with they bombs and they stealth laws. American terrorists and white hoods are in the highest echelons of government. Who's running things? But behind the doors and the club and the dollars, there are curtains. And behind the curtains are stars and moons that you've never seen. Hidden behind this screen. We're blind to the entrance made from the blood, sweat, and tears of our ancestors whose names were never written. Names forgotten. Them ones are the real OGs. See, that's why I gotta do something. Even if I do believe that the system is rigged, because by doing nothing and letting whatever happen, happen. If that's in my head, they've already won. Resistance is a multi-sided prong, and you gotta do battle from every direction. The answer is, I gotta resist each and every way. Let me roll with the system in this moment, working what exists, learning it and tearing it down by infiltration with whatever I can get my hands on. Resistance is a slingshot. And I am David against Goliath. Oh. I'll cast my stone. I'm gonna vote.
Sorry, Mama. Lost track of time.
How was the job search?
Don't nobody want to hire me.
That's not true.
Nah. No. I'm convinced. I went up and down every road for miles, and the only person who showed a lick of interest was a factory guy.
Well, was it good?
What?
The factory, was it a good job?
Yeah, it was a good job, but that's not the point.
Well, what is the point?
I don't want to spend the rest of my life in the line, lifting and scrubbing around to the day I die like Daddy did.
Your daddy was a hard worker.
Worked himself to death. I don't want to go out like that. I don't want to be in constant pain, missing out on important moments with my kids, with my wife, all because I got soles on my feet that's bigger than my hands. Not fair.
What is?
College, Mama. I was an athlete, then I was a soldier. I could have died for this country. I almost did. First thing I saw when I got back in town, rope dangling from a tree. Just waiting on me. I'm supposed to sit here and accept it. Work my jolly factory job and not talk about how I deserve more. I deserve bigger.
I know what you deserve. I'm your mother. I think you deserve the world. If you don't want to sit, then come with me.
I just got home.
Well, that's fine. There's food in the kitchen. Leftovers.
You always have leftovers. Where are you going anyway?
There is a demonstration at the town hall. Me and some of the ladies from the church are going down there.
Why?
Because the colored women are going to vote.
Is that so?
Yes, sir. We are not going to sit and wait for somebody to let us in. We're fighting for it. There's a very important election coming up, and we are going to have our voices heard and our people be able to participate in it just like everybody else. Took women long enough to get the vote in general, and then little Miss Susan B. Anthony, she didn't even want the women who will talk about the women who were on the front line of the fights. I'm a mother. I watched you walk out of that door every morning to go to school for years. And I would have the biggest smile on my face. But as soon as you were out and as soon as I was back in the house, I felt myself suffocating. My heart would drop and my breath died because I didn't know if I'd send my own child off to his own funeral.
Mama, you don't have to worry about
I am tired. You want sunshine and bright futures? You want us to feel at home when we ain't never had a home. A house ain't a home. This is not my home. A country ain't a home. I don't know home. I barely know sanity. And that's why I need to go out there and do something, because our lives are on the line. Our everything. I want a better future for you, for your children. The only way I can change the future is if I'm able to vote for my future. Your daddy wanted to do it, but you're right. He never had the energy to do anything but wake up at 4 a.m. and go to work until 4 p.m.
He was a good man.
He was afraid too. But he still fought. Every mayor, every governor, every senator, he knew they didn't want nothing for him but to be their nigga, and they wanted him to stay their nigga.
Mm-hmm. With nothing in them.
Mm-hmm. Mm. It's about time that changes.
You call me a man, but you don't whip a man in front of his children, leaving scars in his back and in his heart.
How can you call me a person? Lock me in cages and underneath ships, refuse my rights, causing me to march down streets named after presidents who own my family, screaming at the top of my damaged lungs just to be halfway heard, just for you to allow me to send in my ballot, which I can't even do without you dragging me off and throwing me in a cell.
Sometimes I get tired of being black. Every day for me is walking out to the unknown. I want change, but then I turn on the radio and all I hear reports of change makers being shot in the back. It makes it feel impossible.
You sitting down now in that same spot just like your daddy did, with that same tired face. You want to sit there and wait until the world changes and moves in the opposite direction? Or do you want to get up and go with your mama and take her arm and step out there and put your foot down and leave your print in the dirt?
I'm going to change clothes. And I'll meet you there.
Don't you be lying to me, boy.
I'm not, Mama. I'll be there. Before you go, what if that's what I'm supposed to do in my life?
What you mean?
What if first we get the vote and then I become the one we vote for? Well, we can earn the change and then I can be the change. I mean, surely by 1980, 1990, 2000, 2020, things have to be better. They have to be.
I think we need to focus on today. I want to be alive long enough to make my vote. That's all I want. And I want you right there with me when I do it.
Got it, Mama. I'll be there.
Good. You're going to get changed.
I'll see you down there.
I can wait. We can show up together in style.
Sounds good to me.
Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. I just keep on the walk, you know. I keep on. No, don't do that. Don't close the polls up now. People still need to vote. Now, I understand the need in keeping order here for people to cast their vote calmly. But these are not calmly times. We're in the fight of our lives. Never could I have imagined this country in the state that it's in. But it is.
And yeah, I was one of those people who once said that voting was a waste of time and my vote didn't matter anyway. I'm saying that made me lose sight of my mother's struggle and her mother before her to rightfully vote in the first place. I can no longer just stand idly by watching things happen. I've got to act the way that they would want me to, by casting my vote proudly. My community is hurting. And this is the only solution that I can see in playing my part to alleviate our pain. This opportunity that we have to turn the tides of this country with this election is all or nothing. I know we're all fed up with the constant bickering and the back and forth on both sides. Being forced to distance ourselves from family, friends, neighbors, and still not be able to return to a fully functioning society as we've grown accustomed devastates me. But hearing about the thousands of lives that were lost to COVID-19 and the millions more infected with it devastates me even more. As Americans, we have a duty to ourselves and to this country to take part in what happens. And as Delawareans, we have a duty to show more decorum. We hold the future of this country in our hands. We can't squander it. Everyone is equally as passionate about the choices that we came to make. In keeping sound, could we please be equally passionate about forming single file lines so that everyone who's been here for the last several hours can finally get the chance to vote? Thank you.
Ow, that's too tight.
Be still.
Be gentle.
Sorry.
I like that dress. Where'd you get it?
Down the street. I like those shoes.
Yeah. Never thought I'd see another pair of heels again.
You're lucky. I was trying to get my hands on a pair of black pumps, but all I could come up with were these big men's church shoes.
At least they go with the dress.
Yeah. Sure we're making the right decision?
What other choice do we have?
I don't know. Maybe we could become mole people. We could just live underground. Me and you underneath the world. We could be together forever.
Jesse, neither one of us knows anything about living underground. That'll just be a slow, painful death. Having to wake up to darkness every day?
But we'd be together.
We discussed this, Jesse. I love you, sweetie. But the decision has been made.
All done.
I found a piece of glass and newspaper. November
6th, 2020. What does it say?
As President Trump takes his second term, it is clear that major changes will be implemented by the multitudes. Whether or not these changes are good or bad has yet to be determined.
What they meant to say is, It is clear that 45 has no clue what the fuck he's doing, and it's going to ruin us all.
It is clear 45 will ignore Black Lives Matter protesters.
A correction. 45 will do everything he possibly can to obliterate protesters.
Trump vows to show no mercy. Trump makes it illegal to make customers wear a mask. Trump plans to send thousands of troops all over the world and...
Stop. Please. How is he supposed to be the leader of the free world? People saw and heard how evil he was and felt comfortable voting him in or just not voting at all.
And that is why we have to end it all today. It's not going to get any easier, especially not for people of color.
We could band together, start our own country.
How? Half of these countries won't even let us in because that imbecile took zero precautions with COVID. Just kept telling us, go on outside, keep the economy running. You know how many people I lost because they had to keep going to their jobs.
We need to calm down. You know, we're just getting worked up and I don't see that it's gonna help us.
So what? Let me get worked up if I want to. Who do I have to be all cute and calm for, huh? Look around. Ain't nobody here but us. If I want to jump on top of that car out there and get naked, I will. Because civilization is not a thing. Just a bunch of savages hurting anybody in their path. Come on, Pat. Go crazy for once. Try it. You'll love it. As a Black woman, honey, it'll feel good. Not having to act all prim and proper and not be too aggressive for the white folks for once would be a nice change, huh? And even if they were here, fuck them! We tried to save them. Once again, Black women showed up and showed out at the polls. And here we are, the butt of the joke. How many times do we have to try to save the people of this world from themselves? We told them, get up and go vote. Get him out of here. Well, we just Black women, huh?
I think that I understand why so many people just wouldn't care about him. You're screwed if you do.
Screwed if you don't.
Yeah. You ready?
Yeah.
Get you on the other side.
Paul and Silas bound to jail, had no money for to go their bail. So keep your eyes on the prize and hold on. Hold on, hold on, hold on. Keep your eyes on the prize and hold on, hold on. Paul and Silas begin to shout. Jail doors open and they walked out. So keep your eyes on the prize and hold on, hold on, hold on, oh, hold on. Keep your eyes on the prize and hold on, hold on. on. Got my hand on the gospel plow. Ain't packing nothing for my journey now. So keep your eyes on the prize and hold on. Hold on. Yes, hold on. Oh, hold on. Keep your eyes on the prize and hold on. Hold on. Only thing that we've done wrong is stay in the wilderness for so long. So keep your eyes on the prize and hold on. Hold on, hold on, oh, hold on, oh, keep your eyes on the prize and hold on, hold on. Only thing that we've done right is the day that we began the fight. So keep your eyes on the prize and hold on, hold on, oh, hold on, oh, hold on, oh, keep your eyes on the prize and hold on, hold on.
Wow, y'all, that was powerful. Yes, art is powerful, using theater for social change. I just love this idea, right, to start dialogue and have conversations and take action and push things forward. So thank you, thank you, thank you to tonight's playwrights, Chris Eli Black, Jasmine Matthews, Bonnie Scott, and of course, Regina Taylor, for sharing your words with us. And thank you to the cast for sharing your work with us. It was beautiful. I'm grateful. I know our audience is grateful. And if that doesn't make you want to go out and vote, don't worry. We have more coming because it's time for the live panel. It's time to talk about this. Let's dive in and debrief. Without further ado, it's my pleasure to introduce the moderator of tonight's post-show panel discussion. Please join me in welcoming Eddie Francis.
Thank you, Felicia, and good evening, everyone. I'm Eddie Francis. I'm the Director of Communications and Marketing at Dillard University, Louisiana's oldest HBCU, and I'm also the moderator for tonight's discussion. It's my pleasure to be here this evening and to introduce you to this esteemed panel. And let me start with Alana Bell. Alana is the Georgia Program Manager for Care in Action. It's a nonprofit dedicated to the dignity and fairness of domestic workers around the country. There's also Napoleon Bracey joining us. He's a member of the Alabama House of Representatives, former chairman of the Alabama Legislative Black Caucus, and also current chairman of the Mobile County Legislative Delegation. Next is someone I've known for quite some time, Jay Swarobo Inabakari Jr. He is the chairman of the Dallas Community Police Oversight Board and founder of Jay Swarobo's Thoughts, a blog that covers politics, social injustices, and current events. Also, there is Jocelyn Prince. She is a theater artist and activist, and she is the principal at ALJP Consulting. Now, someone who is a very esteemed panelist who could not join us tonight, Regina Taylor. She does send regrets, but let me just tell you about her. She is a Golden Globe Award-winning actress and director and acclaimed playwright. She is currently the Andrew Mellon Foundation Playwright in Residence for the Repertory Theater of St. Louis. In addition to writing a piece for tonight, Vote, was curated and directed by Ms. Taylor. She's a co-producer of tonight's events along with the Oaks Collective. And speaking of the Oaks Collective, there is Diwan Bui. He is 1/5 of that collective, co-producer of tonight's event, and he is also the artistic director for Jubilee Theater in Dallas and a graduate of Dillard University's Theater Department, along with the other members of the Oaks Collective. By the way, I had the opportunity to do a couple of plays at Dillard back in the day. I was so good, they did not invite me back. So let's go ahead and jump right in and let's talk about the topic of the night, the topic of the season. Let's talk about voting. And Diwan Bui, I'm going to start with you. I mean, tonight's work was presented by the Oaks Collective in collaboration with Ms. Taylor. Tell us a story of how this came about.
It came about a mutual conversation. Ms. Regina Taylor was very interested in telling these stories of reaching out and wanting to inspire everyone to get out and vote. At the same time, the Oaks Collective was thinking of what should our next project be. And we also were on that same wavelength of looking at what's happening in the world right now, where we are, and what's coming up. How can we encourage that next generation to take a step forward and to think about not what's coming, but what they can do about it. To ask that question, not what my country can do for me, but what can I do for my country? And the best thing we can do right now is to make our voices heard by voting. And so we wanted to come together by creating that story. And hence we got Ms. Regina Taylor, who was excited about this prospect. And together we reached out to all of the HBCUs and other universities looking for students to submit their work for us to share with one another. We got a nice group, and then we settled on this number of shows. We wanted to make sure that we were respectful of everybody's time, but also presented a series of angles regarding the topic of vote. And the best part about it is we got Ms. Regina Taylor not only to submit a piece, but also to direct and curate this piece. So we were able to, the Oaks Collective was able to really focus on the producing aspects of it and really give that the mantle of directing this show over to Ms. Regina Taylor so that voice can be come through nice and clean.
Let me follow that up with a really quick question about the energy of the cast. I mean, everybody really seemed to put so much energy into the project tonight. Why is everyone so passionate, though, I mean, about voting? And it may seem like an obvious question, but what energized everyone so much to perform the way that they performed when it comes to talking about this topic of voting?
I think a lot of it has to do with the previous election and that notion of who showed up and who did not show up. And it's all of the post conversations and the discoveries of post conversations after the election. Hearing about so many people say, well, I thought I was gonna vote, but I didn't think my vote mattered. Or this is a red state, so he would win anyway. Or well, I wasn't really interested in either one of them, so I didn't bother to vote at all. And so hearing those arguments from so many other people, it became important for us to really create a message about not just today, but making sure our voices are heard throughout.
As a reminder, folks, one of the things that we do want to let you know is that the proceeds from tonight's event will go to the UNCF United Negro College Fund and also will benefit the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. So please don't be shy about giving. Please support. And one other thing I'm really curious about also, Diwan Bui, is that you have these three young playwrights that you referenced a little earlier, Jasmine Matthews, Chris Eli Black, also Bonnie Scott, and you reached out to them. And so why do you feel it was important to prioritize young people when it comes to this project?
Say the best way to reach a young person is by getting another young person. That's the best way to answer that question. And by hearing what they're going through, listening to their perspective, because they're not the only ones feeling it, thinking it, or experiencing it. So by reaching out to that next generation, one, that's part of our mission over here at Jubilee, as well as our mission with the collective, it's about how do we foster that next generation of talent, giving them a voice to be heard so that we can move them forward.
Jocelyn Prince, I want to come to you next. And let's talk about arts. Let's talk about the artists and the role that arts and the arts and artists play in activism. Of course, we hear it all the time from some folks who are, shall we say, they can get a little salty. And so they start saying things like, stick to what you know, to the artists, to the athletes, to the entertainers. But what role do you think that arts have and then the artists have? And why do you think that role is so important?
Yeah, I
think this involvement in activism and political organizing is very important. There's been so many examples throughout history about how the work of artists have supported social change. You can look at the Black Arts Movement, for example, and how that was pushing for social change in the 60s and 70s. If you look at the work of Atho Fugard in the working theater in the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa, you know, storytelling is an essential part of organizing. It's about bringing people together, sharing stories from your own life so that other people can relate to you, inspiring people. Some of the best organizers historically have been incredible storytellers. And artists are particularly adept at creating stories, at creating narratives, at creating worlds that are beyond our imaginations, worlds that are more just, that are more fair for all people. And that creativity is an important part of activist movements. I think that artists, theater artists, performing artists are essential to you know, inspiring people to create social change.
Representative Napoleon Bracey, I'm going to come to you because I know you're chomping at the bit as we're talking about voting. And so we hear a lot about apathy among Black voters, among young voters. However, there are numbers out there that tell us a little bit different. Black people are, we are active voters. Young people get really involved in voting, especially when you have someone like an Obama who came along. When you think about the late 60s. But the people who kind of sit out of the political process, what's the deal with them? And also, how do you engage them?
Okay. First off, I'd like to thank the Oaks Collective for having this tonight and everyone involved. I know it took a lot of hard work and effort to put this on. So first off, thank you. And thank you for giving me a platform and a voice to speak from Alabama about some of the issues that we're all facing. I think we have a responsibility to educate our people as much as possible. A lot of people will go around and say, well, you know, you have to vote because people died for your right to vote. And they'll kind of try to beat that into people or preach it into people. But that's just not working. We have a responsibility of exciting our base. We have a responsibility of making sure that we recruit candidates that speak to the issues that we have in our community and people that speak to the type of change and need that many people are facing in our community. I know a lot of people talk about numbers and they talk about the Obama numbers. Well, if people look up numbers in my election, I put up Obama type numbers in my election. We have a responsibility as candidates and people that's running for office to listen to the people and give the people what they want. You know, a lot of times as elected officials, we'll go out and tell the people what we think they need to hear, but we need to listen to them and deliver to them what they need. And I think that'll get people a little bit excited. And you also have to be a voice for the young people. It's so many people in the African-American community that feels overlooked. You have the younger generation that feels overlooked. You have the people that some people will talk about that may not be as desirable type people, but those people have voices and have votes and they count and matter as well. And it's issues that are important to them as well. So you have to make sure that you can reach across the board and meet people where they are and come down to put it where the hay, put the hay where the horses can get it or whatever. So you have to make sure that you do your part because you have to represent everybody. You know, we don't run for political office and only represent the middle class or only represent the older people that traditionally vote. We represent everybody. So we have to make sure that we try to be that voice and that ear for everybody.
And one thing I'm really wondering about, though, is because you hear folks talk about this all the time and you hear a lot of elected officials say we have to be responsive to the people. How do the people know when an elected official is actually listening to them?
Okay, it's we have a very simple way that we put it in my account. You tell the people what you're going to do. You do it, and then you tell them that you did it. You know, you have to, in every aspect of it, you have to be responsive to the people. They have to know that they can reach out and they can touch you. When I was first elected to the House of Representatives, one of the things that I did that was a strong point for me was I put my cell phone number on the mail outs. And that way I wanted every person in my district to have my personal cell phone number. And believe it or not, people just don't call me for random things and blow my phone up. But if it was important enough to that person to pick up the phone and call me about it, it was important to them. So I need to check on that and deal with that situation. So people need to know that they can reach out and touch you. You shop at the same grocery stores they do. Your kids go to the same schools theirs go to. You go to the same church that them and many of their family members. Those things are very, very important.
Jason Arobo, you have a very interesting role in Dallas, dealing with the Police Oversight Board and being the chair of it. Obviously, police brutality is an issue that is very much on the Black community's minds. However, there are other issues on the table, right? I mean, we are talking about voter suppression, equal pay, gender equality. If you had to look at all those issues and put them all on the table, which ones do you really tend to hear folks talk about the most, maybe?
First of all, I want to thank the Oaks Collective for giving me the opportunity to participate in this auspicious event. I also want to thank the panelists and all of the knowledge that you're going to be dropping. So let's get down to it. One of the misconceptions about the Black community is that we're monolithic. We're not. Some of us, we have concerns about criminal justice reform. Some of us have concerns about marijuana legalization. A lot of us have concerns about student loan debt. And so I think, you know, we are a microcosm of the United States, and we have a lot of the same issues that everyone else does. And the thing about it is that media tends to only shine a light on certain issues. Criminal justice reform, which is something that affects all of us, but it does affect African-Americans in a greater number because of the fact that for every one white person that's arrested, there's probably about 20 more Black people arrested for the same offense. I mean, when you look at, especially when you talk about drug use is equal amongst all races. However, with African-Americans, the incarceration rate is much higher. So I think the thing that we are more focused on is not necessarily those issues that you identify, but the lack of equity in how those issues are resolved within the community. There is no economic equity. There is no educational equity. There isn't even there's no healthcare equity. And we know that when it comes to Black women and their health issues, especially when they're dealing with pain, they may not be prescribed the same type of medications that their white counterparts are because of the fear that the Black woman will become addicted to it. And we all know that when it comes to opioid addiction, who are the ones that are addicted? So I think when we look at all of these issues, we're looking at a equity component and a justice component that is lacking for us.
Alana Bell, you know, just this past week, there were reports on MSN that Black voter ballots were being rejected at nearly four times the rate of white voters. We all know that voter suppression is very real. It's a roadblock for our community. We hear reports like this, and then you have folks who say, my vote doesn't matter. This just proves it. So as someone who really advocates, what do you say to those folks who believe that their votes don't matter?
I would reference something that's been echoed, you know, for the past few decades is our votes wouldn't be suppressed if they didn't matter so much, right? So for myself, moving from Ohio, which is a red-leaning purple state, to Georgia, which is a red state with some purple in it. watching voter suppression and the way it looks has been just like completely baffling to me that legally things have been allowed to go unchallenged and go unchallenged. Basically, when folks say that their vote doesn't count, try again. And that sounds kind of defeating for some people. It doesn't sound incredibly productive for a lot of folks because it's like, I just went through this process already. I don't want to have to go through this again. And I don't want to have to call the voter protection hotline and do all of these things to cast a ballot that someone who lives two zip codes away did with ease. But I would say I would lean in statistics a little bit. A lot of times, especially with state and local elections, the amount of people who didn't vote could very much change the course of an election. It could change like what your legislature looks like. And it is really, really important that we realize that it's all the tactics, right? So a lot of people who aren't voting either because they have experienced voter suppression and they feel like their vote doesn't count that way, or they don't see freedom in their vote, or they don't see their freedom in this election, which is understandable, or whatever the situation may be. But it's all the tactics working in tandem, right? We have to protest and we have to vote and we have to take to the streets and we have to challenge our legislators and we have to do all of these things at the same time, because it's the collective that's gonna make the difference.
Yeah, and I wanna come back to you, Representative Bracey, because there are obviously people who are very concerned that their votes are being suppressed. So if people believe that that's happening, or for the people who know that is happening, what recourse do they have? What can they do?
Well, the first thing, like the young lady mentioned just before, they can call the voter protection hotline at 1-866 our vote, 1-866 our vote. And that's one of the main things that they can do. And she's exactly right. If our vote was not important, people wouldn't try to suppress it. One of the issues that we have here is we have to vote. Even if you feel that your vote is being suppressed, you have to vote. You know, things as simple as the person that's going to be the district attorney that will hold rogue police officers accountable in your community, you have to vote. You know, you have to vote in this presidential election, because you will be picking the person that will be selecting Supreme Court justices that will be able to hold people accountable. They'll have an administration that will be the Attorney General's office, the United States Department of Justice, will be either a Trump or Biden United States Department of Justice. Which one of those will be more friendly towards the needs of the African-American community? This is very, very important, very important. Under the Obama administration, at least we had Eric Holder as our Attorney General. We had a Shelby versus Holder case where one of the whitest counties in the state of Alabama sued Eric Holder, and that's why we don't have the protection that we had under Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act right now, because you had a Supreme Court that overruled it. You know, it was a time that just not long ago, just a few years ago, that any changes to polling places, any changes that could be made with the electoral process anywhere in the United States in this country had to be approved through Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act. We don't have these protections anymore. They are suppressing us. They don't want us to vote, but we have to vote by any means necessary, because it's so important that we put people in place that are sensitive to the needs of our community, because clearly we don't have that right now.
And really quick, I'm so sorry. Thank you for saying that. I also just want to uplift the importance of voting in every election. Right? So it's not just every 4 years that you need to take a trip to the ballot. It is every other year. For Georgia, there are runoff elections, which is another form of voter suppression, making people go out to the polls to do the same, to cast the same ballot that they just cast weeks before. It is important to vote in every election for every position that is on the ballot. Your day-to-day experience is going to be shaped more by the people that you vote in your city council than it is going to be by folks that, I'm just gonna leave it there. Your day-to-day experience is more shaped by your city council and your local officials than it is by any other election.
And if I could chime in, you are exactly right. Can I come right after you? Because I got one more thing.
Here we go. Okay, so all right, let's get to J-Swy Robo.
If I could chime, I just want to just piggyback because of the fact there's so much media coverage of the presidential election. The entire House of Representatives is up for election, and about 30 senators also up for election as well. So when we're talking about the Voting Rights Act, we're talking about, you know, police brutality, all of that stuff. From a national perspective, our Congress could address those issues if we have the right people in Congress. And every seat in the House of Representatives is up for election. And a good portion of Senate seats are up. So we're looking at the fact that right now, because of the fact that there is a Republican majority of the Senate, that they are going to confirm a Supreme Court justice for anything that anyone on this panel believes in. And that's because of the fact that many people slept on those elections. And one of the things I will say is this: African Americans vote at their population percentage, meaning that there is never an election, national election, where we have not voted at our population percentage. Now, if the turnout is 10%, we're still at our population percentage. So let's put that in a context because of the fact that, especially in Texas and Louisiana to a certain degree, and many other states, voter turnout is low. In Texas, voter turnout barely hits the 50 percentile. So just imagine if within that 50 percentile, 70 to 80% of Black folks voted. We would get candidates in office at every level of the ballot that would support our issues. Now, we can talk about engagement, but I'm gonna let my man talk and then we can come back to that because I want to talk about when we need to get engaged in regards to elections.
All right, we do have about 8 minutes left, but Representative Bracey, I'll come back to you.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And this topic is so valuable that, I mean, we could probably talk about this all night long. I was just thinking about the single most important issue on the ballot for me as a Black man is my life. This election to me is so different than so many other elections where people look at it and say, well, this is a life or death situation, or this is the most important election in my lifetime. We've never in my lifetime had a country so divided the way it is right now. And the most important thing to me, even though these issues are so important, raising the minimum wage is important, pay equality for women is important, all these things are important. None of it is important if I'm not here. We have to get to the point that we have to hold people accountable that unjustly kill Black people. Black people are killed so too often by the hands of police officers and nobody's holding them accountable. That's why this election is so important to me. I want to make it home to my family every day. When I leave home in the morning, I have little girls I need to come back to see at night. I don't need to be afraid that if blue lights come on behind me, that I may not make it home. That's an issue for me. That's the most important issue on the ballot, because right now you have an Attorney General of the United States that's not prosecuting these people and not holding them accountable. And then you have attorney generals like in Kentucky that are letting people slide because they want to be on the short list for different appointees and things like that from this sitting president, and they're not doing their job and they're not holding people accountable. My Black life matters, and it matters to my family, and I need to make it home. That's why this election is so important to me, because at any moment things could change and I may not make it home. And my family deserves to have justice. And we need somebody in the White House. We need somebody in the Attorney General's office, these district attorney's office, these police chiefs, sheriffs, these mayors. We need people that's going to hold people accountable for hurting and taking the lives of these innocent Black people?
We only have a couple of minutes left. I want to get a couple of people back in really quickly before we do wrap up. Jocelyn Prince, I want to come back to you really quickly because there are a lot of artists right now who have been, I know, just burning to get back out and to do stuff. And I know there are a lot of artists who are very passionate about making social statements, but they may feel a bit discouraged right now. What would you say to encourage artists to get out there and to make their social statements by any means necessary?
I say to all my fellow theater artists, like, now is the time to be creative. You know, there's lots to be done online. There's lots of virtual ways to make theater. There are site-specific performances you could do outside. In the same way that this country is trying to suppress our vote, we shouldn't also let them or let the country suppress our artistic expression and our creative voice. I think it's really important that we keep our voices up about this. Voting plays a role into the arts industry and the arts economy and the entertainment ecosystem. And we know that Republicans want to continuously cut that funding, cut arts education funding, cut individual funding for artists, attacking the National Endowment for the Arts. And so we have a voice and we have a stake in who's in power too as artists. In addition to just the power that we have as artists to tell stories and help inspire people towards social change. So we got to stay involved. We got to stay creative. We got to stay motivated.
And just a reminder that proceeds for this event do go to the United Negro College Fund, the UNCF, and as well as the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. Dewan Bui, we definitely want to find out what's going on next with the Oaks Collective. I know that we all wish that we could talk a lot more about this thing, but Dewan Bui, I really do want to find out what's going on with you next, what's going on with the Oaks Collective next.
A very special shout out to Miss Regina Taylor. Hope you feel like your presence was here, and also to all of the Oaks Collective members, Jamal Sterling, Nina Domain, Cliff Harvey, and myself, I Kalila Elliott, the mastermind, as well as a good associate with Galford LLC. Together we worked at pulling this thing together, and what we're looking at coming up down the pike next is our family series. Series of stories told by African Griot and just phenomenal storyteller Nina Domain. So we're working on getting those out right now here at Jubilee Theater. We're working on, I know that she'll tell a story. Right now we're working on the story In by Adrian Pender. It is a story of Charles S. Gilpin. He is the first African-American Broadway superstar, and it is a specific word, the N-word, and its use on stage, and in his generation that need not to say that word, and how it interfered with his ability to maintain employment. So we have those projects coming down the line. Please look us up at theoakscollective.com as well as jubileetheater.org. You'll be able to follow us and what we have coming down the pipe. But most importantly, all of us, let's get ourselves out there and make our voices be heard. One whisper cannot be heard, but 1,000 whispers can make a mountain move. So let us work together and making that mountain move.
Many thanks to you. Many thanks to all of our panelists who are here with us tonight. And make sure that if you have the social media handles of these panelists, make sure you follow them. They have a lot of things to say, a lot of great things to say. And I know that they will love to expand on some thoughts that they had additionally tonight. Also to our audience, you've heard us say it once. You've heard us say it 100 times. You're going to hear us say it 100 more times, 1,000 more times, 1,000,000 more times. And that is, if you have not taken the opportunity to register to vote, please take that opportunity to register to vote. It's only going to take you a few minutes. Go to register.vote.org and you can be registered in less than 5 minutes. Now, after you get that precious right to vote, exercise the right to vote. And don't forget to go to the polls and vote on November 3rd. And as you heard the panelists mention, it's not just the presidential election. You're talking about congressional elections. You're talking about your local elections, even your local amendments. Take a look at all of that stuff and exercise your right and exercise your voice, or raise your voice, I should say. Again, proceeds from tonight's event go to UNCF Legal NAACP Legal Defense Fund. Easy for me to say. Again, get out there and vote. And I'm sure Brother Bracey and Brother Ina Bakari would agree with me when I say a voteless people is a hopeless people. It's been a pleasure hanging out with you tonight. And I will go ahead and throw it back on over to Felicia.
Yes, thank you, Eddie Francis, and all of our panelists for being with us tonight and sharing your thoughts about the importance of voting. As you've heard tonight, y'all, your vote is your voice, and it matters. So please, please make sure you are registered to vote in your state and that you go out to the polls to vote on November 3rd. On behalf of the Oaks Collective, Regina Taylor, and all of our amazing guests tonight, thank you for joining us for the presentation of Regina Taylor's Vote, and have a good night.